Good evening. I'm Jeff Swanson with the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Duke University School of Medicine. I'd like to speak with you for a few minutes this evening about two different population health problems that overlap on their margins, gun violence and serious mental illness, and how the clinical legal practice of involuntary outpatient commitment, mandated community treatment for some people with serious mental illness, how that practice emerges as a potentially important policy, but one that's very controversial. I'm going to talk a little bit about outpatient commitment, what it is, where it came from, and you know whether it works, and what it even means to say that it works. You know, do we mean it's cost-effective, that it improves outcomes in behavioral health care systems or the criminal justice system? Do we mean that it actually improves people's lives in ways that matter to them? And that those may be two different things. And I'm going to talk about why it's so controversial among mental health stakeholders and why the evidence for whether it works is actually contested. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about gun violence and how it relates and doesn't relate to mental illness, what science has learned and what the limits of scientific evidence are and what the public believes about this and why all of that is important actually, you know, in the policy efforts, both to improve mental health care and population mental health outcomes and to do something about preventing gun violence in society. And then I'm going to talk about outpatient commitment as a kind of crisis-driven law and how efforts to enact outpatient commitment laws and implement them at the state level actually get intertwined with public safety concerns and with media accounts of mass shootings. And finally, I'd like to say a few things about the normative question, should we do outpatient commitment? When all is said and done, we've looked at all this evidence and thought about it, should we do it? How do we think about the benefits and drawbacks and trade-offs, cost to society and to individuals whose liberty might be limited? How do we think about this policy using ethical principles of distributive justice and autonomy and respect for persons and just humanitarian concerns about human suffering? And in the end, under what conditions should outpatient commitment be implemented, if at all, as a legal practice and as a policy? When you think about outpatient commitment as a kind of crisis-driven law, I don't think the place to start is to talk about the legal features of outpatient commitment. We'll get there, but I think the place to start, you know, when you think about it through the lens of gun violence, is here, a place like this. Newtown, Connecticut, December 2012. This horrible tragedy, a massacre of school children and some of their teachers at Sandy Hook Elementary School. It was a tragedy that stirred this wrenching national conversation. Was it about guns, unregulated firearms? Was it about our violent culture? You know, why did this happen? What could be done to prevent it? Or was it about mental illness? Untreated mental illness, the failure of a mental health care system that is unresponsive and fragmented. And I think in order to understand how outpatient commitment ends up being considered as something in that matrix, that we need to think about some of these different perspectives and conversations, first of all, on their own terms, in order to understand how they converge. So, first of all, you have this perspective, the public health angle, you know, firearms injury and mortality, and, you know, the experts who think about that will tell you, you know, that according to the CDC estimates, on the day of the shooting at Sandy Hook Elementary School, 85 other people died as a result of a gunshot in gang shootings and intimate partner violence and suicides, which is over half of the firearms fatality in the United States. And every day, the day after that, the day after that, 85 people. I mean, it's a massive problem. It's a complex problem. It claims about 31,000, 32,000 lives every year, another 74,000 non-fatal gun injuries. It's the probably second or third leading cause of homicide and suicide are in young Americans aged 15 to 24. And from that perspective, mental illness is an important part of it, but it's a small part of it. We live in a country with lots of guns, and we don't have the option in our policy toolkit to broadly limit legal access to guns like some countries do that say it's just too dangerous to own a gun for your personal protection. We have to do something more difficult, which is to try to identify and limit firearms from, quote, dangerous people. We don't necessarily know who they are, but mental illness becomes relevant in that context as a part of the overall picture of gun injury and mortality in populations. Then we have this perspective. You know, it's your constitutional right. We live in a society, in a culture that has domesticated guns, that celebrates guns, and we have a heck of a lot of them. 310 million firearms in private hands. In some states, over 50% of households have firearms. And we live in a country where the right to own a firearm, the individual right, is fiercely protected and guarded and has been upheld, you know, in our Constitution and how it's been interpreted by the United States Supreme Court. We live in a country where gun-owning interests are represented by very powerful corporate interests and political interest groups. But you ask the National Rifle Association boss, Wayne LaPierre, what does he think the problem is about gun violence and mass shootings and the like? You know what his answer is? Mental illness, right? That's the problem. Why does the NRA keep talking about mental illness instead of guns? The economist asked. What to do about it, you know, in terms of the policy suggestion? Well, Wayne LaPierre said, we have no national database of these lunatics. That's what he told David Gregory on Meet the Press. This is from a man who vehemently, stridently opposes any kind of a gun registry for owners of firearms. And that's why he opposes background checks. Now, that might seem like an extreme opinion, but there's actually common ground between Wayne LaPierre and a really mainstream journalist such as Joe Klein, who counts himself among the anti-gun crowd, who is a gun control advocate. Now, he's worried about background checks. Why? Because they don't go far enough. He thinks it's a tepid measure, and he's worried that people will say, okay, we did something about gun violence. But in his view, it doesn't address the most significant piece of the problem, which is what? Mental illness, the mental health issue. And he thinks we're making a terrible mistake, he says, if we don't oppose not only the gun nuts, as he calls them, but the civil libertarians. What does he mean by that? He means people who advocate for people with mental illness to make their own decisions, have their own autonomy, can make decisions about whether they want to be in treatment, be in the community with the rest of us. And people like Joe Klein and lots of people who agree with him take the view that, well, this is a problem, you know, that is related to gun violence. Across the population, look at a public opinion poll from the early days after the Sandy Hook shooting, and we find that majorities of adults in this country favor the idea of increasing government spending on mental health treatment and screening as a strategy to reduce gun violence. That's remarkable, you know, given that the question asks about increasing government spending. I mean, you're going to lose half the population right there who, you know, if you ask about that, you know, the answer is no. So that is really a remarkable. You see this common theme across this diverse population that totally disagrees on the issue of firearms. Now, what does this have to do with violence and mental illness? It has a lot to do with it, actually. It turns out that 60% of adults in this country believe that people with schizophrenia are likely or very likely to be dangerous. 46% of the adults in this country believe that people with mental illness are more dangerous by far than the general population. Now, why is that important? Well, first of all, it's wrong, but it's also important because people act on the basis of what they believe to be true. If they believe that mentally ill people are dangerous and to be feared, they will act accordingly. They will reject them. They'll treat them with scorn, and they'll want to be distant from them, and in the end, they might discriminate against them, you know, in the distribution of all the rights and benefits and opportunities of our society. And there's a huge disconnect, because if you look at the epidemiological evidence on violence and mental illness, you know, only 12% of people with schizophrenia will commit even a minor act of violence. Could be something like pushing or shoving or slapping somebody in the face in a year. You know, that's from the epidemiologic catchment area study that NIMH did in around 1990, but this has been corroborated in a number of other studies. Substance abuse actually does increase violence. If you factor that out, you know, the absolute risk of violent behavior of people with serious mental illness, depression, major depression, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia is about 7%. If you want to talk about what people are really worried about, homicide against a stranger, you know, somebody with a psychotic disorder doing that, that's about 1 in 70,000 people with schizophrenia. You know, so 69,999 are not going to do this. So it's a huge disconnect. That being said, there are periods of time in the life of someone with serious mental illness when violence risk is elevated. And if you look at this data from this meta-analysis, these orange bars here show the average prevalence of violent behavior, and all these studies have been done, organized by the setting in which they've been done. So as you move from the general population without mental illness to outpatients of treatment, representative community samples, as you start to get to the settings in which people encounter the mental health care system in a crisis, people who've been in the hospital, people who are presented emergency departments, that's 23% involuntarily committed patients. That shouldn't be that surprising because the criteria for involuntary commitment involve a dangerousness or can. And the first episode psychosis patients, these are people you know, untreated in the first episode before they presented for care, and the lead up to that, how many of them have been violent. And those differences could be different populations. They could also be different periods in the illness and treatment career of the same people. But overall, you look at the attributable risk of violence associated with serious mental illness, it's about 4%, you know, factoring out substance abuse. So you know, we could cure these miserable diseases tomorrow, and that would be a great thing. Our violence problem, largely determined by other things, would still be with us. The bigger issue, of course, is we really do have a lot of people in this country with serious disabling mental health conditions who aren't getting any treatment or aren't getting adequate treatment. You know, one estimate is 3.5 million people with serious mental illness who are not being treated. That doesn't have a lot to do with violence, but it's a serious problem, and it's a problem that comes to light when the public is concerned about violence. So where does that leave the mental health stakeholders? You know, I mean, they're perfectly eager to have a conversation about how to fix our mental health care system. It's fragmented, it's overburdened, it's under-responsive. It's a disaster in some states. People don't have access to evidence-based treatments. So here you've got the dilemma, right? People want to talk about that, but the idea of using the occasion of the public's concern about gun violence to do so, you know, makes us kind of cringe. But that's a conversation we're having, and we can't help it. We are simultaneously in a position of trying to debunk the idea that mentally ill people are dangerous, and at the same time leverage that public concern to focus attention on the needs of the mental health care system and people with mental illness, while at the same time avoiding spawning crisis-driven laws that could overreach and actually have a deleterious effect in terms of reinforcing the stigma associated with mental illness, or needlessly overriding the liberty and the privacy, invading the privacy of people with mental illness. So I think about this as this sort of river here, and on the far shore you have gun rights territory, and on the near shore here you have gun control territory. Never the twain shall meet, but there's this rickety bridge there. And what's that? That's the mental health care system. And, you know, there's that one common, square inch of real estate between the two. And there's the you know, benighted mental health stakeholder hoping not to slip through the cracks. What happens as a result? Well, here's an example of crisis-driven policy, crisis-driven law. In the early days after the Sandy Hook shooting, Governor Andrew Cuomo of the New York State Legislature pushed through the New York Secure Ammunition and Firearms Enforcement Act, the New York SAFE Act. And it did some things that, public health-minded gun violence prevention experts would probably applaud. It requires universal background checks, increases penalties for people who use illegal guns, beef stuff enforcement, bans assault weapons and high-capacity ammunition magazines. Federal law used to do that. Some people think it still should. But then the New York SAFE Act reached deep into mental health territory. While we're at it, why don't we require mental health professionals to report persons at risk of harming themselves or others to the police so that the police can match those names to the gun permit registry and remove firearms from ostensibly dangerous people. You know, never mind that this might actually have the effect of keeping people away from treatment, putting a chill on people's help seeking and maybe and their disclosures in therapy. It created some strange bedfellows. You know, the psychiatric establishment opposed it, and the gun rights gun lobby opposed the law for different reasons. And when you got, you know, that spectrum of people opposing a law on the same side of the issue, you know that something weird's going on. But also, the New York SAFE Act expanded outpatient commitment, Kendra's Law. That's really interesting. What did it do? It made the initial period of court-mandated treatment longer, from 6 months to 12 months. It required outpatient commitment or assisted outpatient treatment, AOT as it's called in New York, for released prisoners coming out of the criminal justice system, somebody coming out of the DOC who's mentally ill, has been in a prison hospital. They have to be considered for a period of civil mandated outpatient treatment after the criminal sentence is completed. And it made the orders follow patients from county to county when they move to be transferable across counties. Those provisions, you know, they may not be all that big a deal, but they're interesting because if you followed this issue, you've seen that they've been proposed, you know, for quite a while before this and hadn't got any traction. And then all of a sudden, after the mass shooting, the proponents of these reforms to outpatient commitment saw, here's Governor Cuomo's gun control express heading out of the station, and these provisions hopped on board. Flash forward a year, you know, I said that the Sandy Hook tragedy was unspeakable. It didn't stop people from speaking about it. The words have poured out by the millions. And after all that talk, an executive order from the White House, two executive orders in January 3rd, 2014, one was about HIPAA, giving explicit permission to covered entities to provide the information necessary to identify people with gun disqualifying mental health records without running afoul of HIPAA. The other one, outpatient commitment, making sure that people who have had an outpatient commitment order would be explicitly added to the list of prohibited persons from firearms. Again, might not have much of an impact, because if you know how outpatient commitment works, you realize that the vast majority of people who are subjected to outpatient commitment orders are already disqualified from firearms. Why? Because they start with an involuntary inpatient hospitalization. That is, if they're committed, that is already prohibiting under federal law. But it's interesting that this policy, you know, made it onto this short list of things that the White House wanted to do to improve background checks, specifically with respect to individuals prohibited under federal law from having a gun for mental health reasons. So let's back up a little bit and think about outpatient commitment a little bit differently. The basics of outpatient commitment, what is it? It's an outpatient version of involuntary commitment to a psychiatric hospital. It's a less restrictive alternative. It essentially extends the state's commitment authority from the institutional setting into the community, to community-based mental health care. It's a civil court order that requires the patient to comply with treatment and also arguably, such as medication and case management, and arguably also commits the system to the patient. It's a treatment plan wrapped in a legal order, or you could think of it as a legal vessel with a treatment plan inside. Another way of thinking about it is leveraged community treatment, where the lever, the sanction, is involuntary hospitalization. That's what can be done if someone doesn't comply with an outpatient commitment order. They can be transported by law enforcement to a mental health care facility to evaluate whether they meet commitment criteria to be hospitalized. So that's the threat of that is the lever. There's actually no such thing, except with very rare and somewhat strange exceptions, forced medication in the outpatient setting. That typically is not part of outpatient commitment. This whole policy kind of emerged in, you know, out of the ashes of deinstitutionalization as a way to deal with this population of a small number of people who established a pattern of revolving door hospitalizations in and out of state mental hospitals and didn't do very well in the community and either couldn't or didn't or would not comply with treatment. And so this was seen as a way to try to deal with that problem. There are three types of outpatient commitment from a legal point of view. One is a kind of a species of conditional release. There's formal conditional release, but actually most of the outpatient commitment today is a kind of conditional release because it starts in the hospital. It allows people to step down and to leave earlier than they would otherwise and to move into a less restrictive setting of the outpatient treatment. The second form is alternatives to hospital and alternative hospitalization for people who already meet the criteria for inpatient commitment. 33 states have that, and in order to get that, you have to meet the criteria for involuntary hospitalization. So it's not used very much in those states, and partly because, you know, if you think about it, having gone to the trouble to show that someone is dangerous, for example, and meets commitment criteria, some psychiatrists are then reluctant to release somebody into the community. Due to liability concerns or what have you, as Paul Applebaum has pointed out in print. The final kind of outpatient commitment is preventive outpatient commitment. 10 states have that. That's actually the most controversial kind. It's the one about which there's the most evidence and the most discussion. And that is a form of outpatient commitment where a person can be put on a court order at a lower threshold than inpatient commitment. With the idea that it will prevent further deterioration. It's controversial because, you know, the civil libertarians will say, look, I might have a mental illness. I'm not imminently dangerous. I'm not incompetent. I'm not a child. I'm not unconscious. And I'm not criminally accused. So on what basis are you, the state, going to override my right to be free, to be left alone, and to refuse treatment and put me in the hospital? We live in a society that allows people to do all kinds of things, even if they're not in their best interest. You know, you can't use police powers. I'm not dangerous. You can't use pars patriae. I'm not incompetent. So, you know, is this legitimate? Is it constitutional? If you line up the criteria, inpatient versus outpatient, you see on the one side you have inpatient criteria, danger to self or others, in need of protection or treatment for health and safety because of a mental disorder, gravely disabled. On the outpatient side, outpatient commitment, mentally ill, capable of surviving safely in the community with supports, and based on psychiatric history, the respondent is in need of treatment to prevent further deterioration. Current mental status negates or limits the ability to comply voluntarily. So there are these kind of nested predictions there. One is that based on a person's history, they're unlikely without the court supervision to comply voluntarily with treatment. And when they don't comply, they're likely to deteriorate clinically. And when they do deteriorate, they're likely to become dangerous to themselves or others. Now, whether the science is there to make those kinds of predictions at the individual level, that's another question. But that's kind of the logic of it. How common is outpatient commitment? Well, you've seen it's either permitted or explicitly authorized in 45 states. We did a study some years ago sponsored by the MacArthur Research Network on mandated community treatment, and we did this in five states, a pooled sample of about 1,000 public psychiatric outpatients. And we looked at outpatient commitment in the context of other kinds of practices that you could call leveraged community treatment. Criminal sanctions, such as people who involve the criminal justice system, mental health courts or jail diversion, or, you know, specialized probation, community corrections, where there's some kind of lever held over the individual due to criminal justice connection that says, you know, that they have to participate in treatment. There's money. People with disabilities who might be receiving a check from the Social Security Administration with a representative payee who might say, if you're going to get your spending money, you have to go to the mental health center and take medication. People do that. These are kind of common practices, according to our study. Housing. People with subsidized housing, same issue. And housing and money leverage are actually seen as more coercive than outpatient commitment. But if you believe this prevalence survey, these are not that uncommon. Overall, 45 to 59% of the sample had experienced one or more of these kinds of leverage. And 12% to 20% across states had experienced some kind of outpatient commitment. Who are the people who experience these kinds of leveraged treatment practices? They tend to be younger patients, people with more severe and disabling conditions, people with longer lasting conditions, people with patterns of multiple hospital readmissions and intensive outpatient service use. They're people in the system. They also tend to be people who, by their own admission, don't take medication voluntarily, and people with some kind of history of assaultive behavior. That combination, if you look at the orange bar there, about almost 40% of the people who have that combination of not taking medication voluntarily and having some history of assaultive behavior have been subjected to some kind of legally leveraged outpatient treatment. So where does that leave us? Where are we with outpatient commitment policy? It's interesting to go back 25 years ago. Robert Miller wrote about outpatient commitment. At that time, it was this kind of promising but unproven legal practice, lots of interest in it. And Miller said this. He said three things are going to be needed for this policy to actually fulfill its promise and benefit people. One, we need rigorous empirical research to show whether it works and for which patients it works. Number two, we're going to need support from community-based clinicians. If they don't buy into it, it's never going to get any traction, won't be widely implemented. And third, we're going to need sufficient resources, this is key, to permit adequate treatment to be provided. Otherwise, he said, outpatient commitment is all too likely to remain a theoretical but not practical alternative to revolving door hospitalizations and community neglect. Well, it's still very controversial, and arguably they're just dwindling public funds to implement the services that outpatient commitment is designed to deliver to people who might not get it otherwise. Lots of barriers to care. Some people argue that it's really an access issue, not a legal issue. But here we are. As I say, very controversial. These two gentlemen you see here, Robert Bernstein, Executive Director of the Judge David Bazelon Center for Mental Health Law, and on the right, E. Fuller Torrey of the Treatment Advocacy Center, represent two views opposing and favoring outpatient commitment, two interlocutors in this kind of debate that are representative. You might characterize their positions as autonomy and rights versus benign paternalism. Fuller Torrey's argument, he makes arguments for outpatient commitment on a number of grounds, but one of them is humanitarian. He says, is it fair on humane grounds alone to leave those who are not aware of their own illness living in the streets and eating out of garbage cans? You would not do this with your grandmother with Alzheimer's disease. Why is it okay to do this with young adults with schizophrenia? And then he plays the kind of the public safety card. He says an individual with schizophrenia or bipolar disorder who's not being treated is like a person with untreated epilepsy who's driving a car, or a person with untreated active tuberculosis who is sitting next to you in a movie theater. In both cases, we require that these individuals receive treatment. He goes on to say that civil libertarians have made it almost impossible to treat psychotic individuals who refuse care. He calls them misguided activists who throw up all these obstacles. And he said, you can't treat psychotic individuals until they have a finger on the trigger. And that's a deliberate turn of phrase, I can assure you. Mandatory treatment, he says, for these too ill to recognize they need help is more humane than our present system of mandatory non-treatment. So in his view, the chains are the mental illness and not the law that requires treatment. Bob Bernstein, Bazelon Center, opposes outpatient commitment. He says there's no evidence that it improves public safety, so he makes an argument about the evidence. And he says failure to engage people with serious mental illness is a service problem, not a legal problem. Outpatient commitment is not a quick fix that can overcome the inadequacies of an under-resourced and underperforming mental health system. Coercion, even with judicial sanction, is not a substitute for quality services. So that's their view, that this is a problem about access. And how do you fix that? You don't fix it by passing a law to force people into treatment. You fix it by investing in a system that's going to be more responsive, that'll outreach to people and provide evidence-based treatment to people in a way that they can that they can benefit from it. Let's tell the outpatient commitment story in yet another way. All right, these are three individuals here, three young men, Mr. G, Mr. T, and Mr. W. Let me talk about them individually. They might sound pretty familiar to you if you're a public sector psychiatrist. Mr. G, age 29, a client of the New York State mental health system. He's been diagnosed with schizophrenia. He's had 13 psychiatric hospitalizations in 2 years, brief and all voluntary. He has an extensive history of assaultive behavior against staff. He's been intermittently homeless. He repeatedly is seeking long-term hospitalizations. He wants to be in the hospital. He wants something different. He's demanding it. He's on a wait list. The services that he wants are not available. And he stopped taking his medications. Mr. T is a client of the Nevada County, California Behavioral Health Care Department. He has been diagnosed with depression and anxiety and severe agoraphobia and some paranoid symptoms. He uses marijuana. He's hurt his back and he's using prescription pain medications. He lives alone. He has guns. He frequents gun shows and possesses firearms. He's been arrested for drunk driving. And he has a lot of anger against the mental health clinic. He is seeking additional help. He wants a change, wants a different psychiatrist, something else, and he's knocking on the door, too. Then you got Mr. W. He's a client of the Kalamazoo County, Michigan County Mental Health Program. He has been diagnosed with schizophrenia. He has a 20-year history of multiple psychiatric hospitalizations and arrests for minor offenses. He is living in a group home. He stopped taking his prescribed medications. He has been arrested recently brandishing a knife, was released and not committed. So, you know, what's different about these three guys? Probably sounds like a lot of people who are struggling with mental illness in the care systems that we have. Why am I showing you their pictures? Why do I have their pictures up here? Well, it's because their names are Andrew Goldstein, Scott Harlan Thorpe, and Brian Williams, and each of them is well known because why they committed a homicide. And they committed a homicide, and the victim in each case, the person that they killed, became the namesake of an eponymous outpatient commitment statute. So Andrew Goldstein killed Kendra Webdale, promising young writer, pushed her in front of a subway train in 1999. And New York enacted Kendra's law. Scott Harlan Thorpe shot Laura Wilcox and others in the behavioral health clinic in California. Laura Wilcox, a very talented young college student. Brian Williams killed Kevin Heisinger, a University of Michigan graduate student, 2000. Killed Mr. Heisinger with his fist in a public restroom in the Kalamazoo bus station. And so we have Kendra's law and Laura's law and Kevin's law. Only one of these three, just as an interesting point, used a firearm. Scott Harlan Thorpe used a gun. Andrew Goldstein pushed Kendra in front of a train. Brian Williams used his fist. Interestingly, the shooting by Mr. Thorpe was the only one with multiple victims. The others only had one victim. Andrew Goldstein pleaded insanity, not guilty by reason of insanity. That defense failed. He was convicted of second-degree murder. He's serving a sentence of 25 years to life in state prison. Scott Thorpe was found incompetent to stand trial. He was committed to Napa State Hospital. And Brian Williams was found not guilty by reason of insanity, and he was committed to the Ypsilanti Center for Forensic Psychiatry. So here's a question. Would Kendra's and Laura's and Kevin's law have saved Kendra and Laura and Kevin? And is that the right question? Notice that these laws were not named Andrew's Law or Scott's Law or Brian's Law. But these young men who committed these homicides, their lives also came to an end as they knew them. And this was a tragedy for them, too. Arguably, if you think about outpatient commitments function as taking someone who's refusing treatment and forcing them to accept treatment, overriding their refusal, that really wasn't the issue with these young men. The problem arguably was that the treatment they were receiving didn't work very well, and they were not getting the level of intensive outreach and support that they needed. Would you need a law to provide that? Maybe, maybe not. If you think about outpatient commitment as having a function of committing a system to a person and wrapping a plan for intensive treatment, like putting somebody on an ACT team, you could ask the question, if these young men were put on ACT teams, would that have made a difference? But that's maybe a different question. Also, when you look at how these laws were implemented, in only one of the states, New York, was there really a serious effort to implement the outpatient commitment statute. It never really got anywhere in California, partly because it was set up in such a way that, and the opponents wanted it this way, that each individual county in California had to approve it on its own and appropriate money for it. So it got a very, very limited implementation. In Michigan, if you talk to some psychiatrists there, the way the statute was written makes it difficult to implement because people have to be found to be dangerous. What's undeniable is that these laws wouldn't exist if it weren't for these incidents, because that was the occasion that the advocates, such as the Treatment Advocacy Center, used to galvanize public support for these laws, public that might not have cared about some marginalized group of individuals with mental illness, but do care about public safety. And that is kind of a two-edged sword. So does outpatient commitment work? Well, the answer to that is it depends. It depends on a lot of things. What do we mean by outpatient commitment? As I've said, there are different types of outpatient commitment. If we're talking about the kind where people actually have to meet the criteria for inpatient commitment, that's very different than asking the question whether a preventive outpatient commitment statute works. What do we mean by the term work? I mean, what's the goal? What's the outcome we're looking at? Are we looking at whether outpatient commitment reduces hospitalizations? Maybe in some cases it should increase people's opportunity to be hospitalized when they need inpatient treatment. Are we talking about quality of life? Are we talking about saving the system money, you know, across state agency budgets? What's the goal of outpatient commitment? And does it work compared to what? Compared to people who are receiving treatment voluntarily, people without mental illness, people in an ideally funded mental health care system, comparing people, the same people before and after outpatient commitment, the comparison group makes a big difference. And for whom? Are we talking about everybody with serious mental illness or this small group who don't comply with recommended treatment? Does it work for substance abusers? Does it work for people with schizophrenia? Does it work for, you know, people in different demographic groups, you know, with different positions of social structure? Does it work where? I mean, just because it was shown to be effective in some ways in Central North Carolina doesn't, or in Manhattan, doesn't mean it's going to work in the UK or in New Mexico in a system that's very different, populations that are different, laws that are different, different levels of investment and organization and financing of the mental health care system. And does it work for, you know, how? I mean, what's the mechanism? Does it work by improving treatment compliance to the individual, you know, because they are impressed by the moral authority of a guy in a black robe? Does it work because the system feels obligated to give people priority and give them support and housing and stuff like that? Does it have to be held in place forever? You know, for how long? Is it like a prosthetic device to keep people in treatment, or is it a short-term boost to re-engage someone in voluntary treatment, after which they will be able to recover on their own terms and maybe have greater autonomy in the long run. And does it work? So what? So what if it does? I mean, does that mean we should do it? There are things that work that have an effect that we shouldn't do, maybe because of ethical concerns or because of cost considerations. You know, there are lots of examples in other areas of medicine where something will have an effective result mechanically, but it doesn't make any sense to do it. So what is the evidence? Well, looking across a number of outcomes, I mean, you can look at the evidence reviews. There are several of them. There's been a Cochrane Collaborative report that came to the conclusion that there was not much evidence that outpatient commitment worked. There are partisans who have strong feelings about it one way or the other, and tend to have different views on the evidence as well. There have been three United States studies that have gotten a lot of attention. There's a study, the Bellevue study of the pilot AOT program at Bellevue Hospital. That showed a kind of a null result. It was a small randomized trial, small study, had some problems. It was done right when the program was starting up. Arguably, people didn't necessarily know which arm of the study they were in. There was confusion about the court order versus the treatment. There were more people with substance abuse in the committed group. So, you know, there were methodological issues there. The Duke Mental Health Study, which I was involved in the 1990s, is probably the study that's got the most attention over time. That was a randomized trial. But as I'll show you, there's controversy about the way in which we analyze the data, because while we randomized assignment to outpatient commitment, we were not able to randomize how much outpatient commitment got, and that ended up having a big impact and make very important to the outcomes that people got, and there's argument about whether that's selection bias or not. Then there was the New York AOT study, a legislatively mandated evaluation of the largest experiment with outpatient commitment in New York, which was recently completed, looked at a bunch of outcomes, and that had positive results, but again was a quasi-experimental study, not a randomized trial, and it was difficult to find a comparison group that would actually be similarly situated to people on AOT. I would say a fair-minded reading of this literature would conclude that the evidence is mixed, and that there is pretty strong evidence for success, but it's conditioned on investment and effective implementation. It's conditioned on the availability of intensive community-based services in the community and the duration of the court order. I mean, it's not something that's going to work with a very, very brief intervention. You know, our studies have found, as I'll show you, that it probably takes 6 months or more in outpatient commitment to show an effect. But not everyone agrees with what I just said. I mean, since even that qualified endorsement rests on valuing results from quasi-experimental analyses alongside of presumed, the gold standard of RCTs. Just to get specific here, here's a key result from the Duke Mental Health Study looking at hospitalization outcomes, people randomly assigned to outpatient commitment or not, base population of over 300 people. And the district court judges agreed to randomly assign people who already had an outpatient commitment order, and the people who were assigned to the control group had that order vacated and left the hospital on voluntary case management. We followed people up over a year's time and looked at all kinds of outcomes, including their rehospitalization. And you can see here that with a month-by-month repeated measures analysis, that the outpatient commitment group randomly assigned had a lower probability odds of being hospitalized. But we also looked at the data, and we saw a very interesting pattern that we thought was important, and that is that the duration of the order, which was not subjected to randomized control, actually had a big impact. And so if you looked at people who got really a brief period of outpatient commitment and then were released, they didn't really differ from the control group. And the entire effect was really carried by people who had long-term outpatient commitment on average all year. So that we thought was important as a policy matter, but as a methodological issue, it raised all kinds of controversy because of the fact that we didn't randomize that. And the critics could say, well, you know, the people who are doing well anyway were the ones who got the long-term outpatient commitment. Here's the same finding. Look at hospital days. You can see 7.51 on average for that long-term group. We also found an interaction with intensive services. So if you look at those three trend lines on the left there, in that left panel, that's the cumulative number of hospitalizations people had. The green line is people with long-term outpatient commitment. The blue line is people who got short-term outpatient commitment, and the red line is people who got none. And as you can see, there is a separation, but that was not statistically significant. On the right, when you confine this to people who got more than three service events per month, that's when you really see that separation, and the long-term outpatient committed group had far better outcomes. So arguably, it's the combination of the outpatient commitment order and the intensive services. The violence at baseline, we looked at these 331 people with three sources of information about violence: self-report, other report, criminal records, clinical records. 33% had no threats or violent acts. 17% had verbal threats only. 32% had committed an act that would be defined as simple battery without causing injury, and 18% had committed some kind of serious violent act. If you unpack that, a third of that, or 13% of the total, of those individuals had done something with a weapon in hand, making a threat but hadn't caused an injury. 14%, or 2% of the total, had caused an injury without using a weapon, and this little group here, 3% of the total, had injured someone using a weapon. So that's 3% of the involuntarily committed group that were put on this study, and interestingly, that's what corresponds to the idea in the public mind of violence and mental illness, and it's a real disconnect with these findings. And it's also interesting because involuntary commitment is a gun disqualifying adjudication, and clearly not everybody in this group was violent. Follow these people up for a year and look at violence in people with outpatient commitment, none, brief, and long, and we found a very similar result to what I showed you with hospitalizations, that people with extended outpatient commitment had significantly lower odds of violence, and in predicted probabilities terms, it translates to a kind of a, you know, cutting in half of the likelihood of violence from 42% to 24% on people with extended outpatient commitment. Victimization, that's an issue. People with mental illness are way more likely to be victims of violent crime than they are to be perpetrators. And we got an interesting straight-up randomized analysis result here with people assigned to the outpatient committed group significantly less likely to be victims of violent crime over the 1 year of follow-up. Let me say a couple things about the AOT study in New York. This was a much bigger study. We looked at, you know, lots of observations comparing and bringing together data from the Medicaid claims databases. 3,576 individuals placed on AOT over the period from 1999 to 2007. It was an observational study with multivariable analysis of these time series events. Looking at hospital use, medications, whether people were receiving assertive community treatment, intensive case management, and so on. In general, in a nutshell, we found outpatient treatment, medication possession up, hospital admission, days hospitalized down. The longer people remained on outpatient commitment, the better, generally. And then we looked at case manager data, and this is actually important because with the case manager report data, we were able to compare people with an interesting combination: people who were on assertive community treatment teams and had AOT versus people just on assertive community treatment. Because, you know, the critics of outpatient commitment often say, well, if you just put someone on assertive community treatment, they're going to do just as well without the court order. And we found that that was actually not so, that people who received outpatient commitment or AOT with ACT did better in terms of reduced hospitalization than people on ACT teams alone, controlling for covariates in this analysis. What about cost? Let me call your attention to this finding here. This is sort of monetizing everything, looking at the cost of AOT, the cost of services, cost of hospitalization. Key finding there, comparing three periods of time, the 12 months before people were put on AOT, the 12 months during, and then 12 months after, the second 12-month period after they initiated AOT, and you can see without patient mental health treatment, it goes way up. The cost goes from $5,000 per person on average to $15,000 during the first 12 months and $12,000 or so in the second 12 months. Now, that's offset in a big way when you look at the hospital data because the pattern is upside down. Huge decline in the average inpatient cost, both in terms of hospitalizations in the New York State Office of Mental Health Facilities and in Medicaid hospitalizations, way down from an average of $49,000, $47,000 to a fraction of that in the year following, in the subsequent year. So those are some system outcomes. Well, what about the people themselves? People actually receive outpatient commitment or AOT. What do they think? Do they care? So here are a couple of papers I'm going to tell you about briefly. One measured quality of life, subjective quality of life. Another looked at endorsement of personal benefit. People who have had an AOT, and at the end of the day, if you ask them, was this a good thing for you? Do you endorse this personally? What's the answer there? And then there's a formal preference assessment. You know, if you ask people to trade off, you know, the downside of being in the hospital versus the downside of having outpatient commitment, what's more important, what's more salient. So these bar graphs show you the differences in the average change score, the change in rank on quality of life over one period. And you can see, and those are the averages with the error bars around them, and you can see that the group of people with renewed long-term outpatient commitment had a substantially higher improved change in their quality of life compared to their counterparts who were in the control group or non-renewed AOT. So that looks good, you know, controlling for baseline quality of life and a bunch of covariates. But it's a more complicated story. If you look at this in a kind of a path analytic framework, so the total number of outpatient commitment or AOT days actually had a significant relationship in the positive direction with quality of life. More days on outpatient commitment or AOT, higher quality of life. But if you put two other variables in there, these mediators, increased service use and decreased symptoms, the direct path is not significant, and the pathway actually is a positive indirect effect. With more days of outpatient commitment, increasing service use, that increasing service use being associated with decreased symptoms and that increasing subjective quality of life. So that again sounds good, but there's another interesting story here, which is there's a negative indirect effect by means of increased coercion. So the more days of AOT people had, the more coerced they felt. The more coerced they felt, the worse their quality of life. And that too had a negative indirect effect. So you have a positive indirect effect by means of increased service use and lower symptoms, a negative indirect effect by means of increased coercion. So it's kind of like a treatment where there's a benefit, but there's a downside. So the question is, how do you trade that off? Well, statistically speaking, this effect here of decreased symptoms had a much stronger impact on subjective quality of life than did the downside of increased coercion. For what that's worth. What about endorsing outpatient commitment, the personal benefit of it? At the end of the day, did you think it was a good thing for you? Well, if we had to justify outpatient commitment on the basis of personal endorsement, you know, the thank you theory after the fact, not going to get there. 27% of the people who had outpatient commitment in our study said that it was a good thing for them. You do get a little bit better result by stratifying the outcome on the basis of outcomes. So if you just look separately at people who had a positive result on outpatient commitment, they weren't hospitalized, they didn't get in fights or violent incidents, they had, at the end of the day, an above average score on the global assessment of functioning, and compared them to people who had a negative outcome on all those three things, and you get this really significant difference. 20% of the people with negative outcomes endorsed outpatient commitment versus 45% who had all positive outcomes. Now notice, you only get to 45%. This still means 55% of the people even had positive outcomes on outpatient commitment did not personally endorse it as a positive thing for them. So you need to think about the criteria. What about the formal preference assessment? Just to summarize this briefly, we showed people, gave people vignettes to read where a person was described, Mr. Smith, as being hospitalized, being on outpatient commitment, variations on this, various iterations of it, and permutations. And basically, the statistical result is that people give a far higher preference weighting and importance weighting and a salience to avoiding hospitalization. That's much more important to them than the benefit of avoiding the coercion of outpatient commitment. Is AOT fair? There was a prominent report by the New York Lawyers for the Public Interest, which made the provocative claim that outpatient commitment in New York AOT was racist. Because if you looked at the distribution by race of people on AOT compared to the state of New York, you would calculate that you had a 5 times increased chance of getting on AOT if you're black compared to if you're white. So we kind of deconstructed that analysis. I'm going to show you that in a minute. And then there's this question about queue jumping. If you think about it, if you have a system where there's mental health care is a scarce good, people are figuratively lined up waiting to get it, and there's not enough to go around, and then here comes somebody with a court order to the front of the line and they get treated first, even if they didn't want to, is that fair? Are we unfairly disadvantaging people who voluntarily want services and need them in the same way? And we looked at that as well. With respect to the racial disparities, what we did is we organized these data and looked at them with different denominators. So the first one was the one that the Lawyers for Public Interest looked at. If you just look at the county population, our calculation was 7-1, the disparity of African American versus whites of greater chance of being subjected to outpatient commitment or AOT. If you shrink the denominator to the estimated number who actually have serious mental illness and use the same numerator there, it goes way down to 4-1. If you look at the county population actually in the public sector mental health system who are receiving OMH services, it goes down to 2-1. If you then look at the denominator, just people who have been hospitalized, and then you look at people who have been involuntarily hospitalized, it goes away completely. So our conclusion was, yes, there might be racial disparities in the system. They're way upstream from the decision maker who says, I'm going to put somebody or petition somebody or order somebody to outpatient commitment. These are disparities that have to do with the correlation between poverty and race, with who's in the public system, with who has insurance, with who gets committed, and so on. So it's complicated. What about the queue jumping argument? We call this the Neapolitan ice cream slide, and these are trend lines showing the change in number of Medicaid claims month by month by month for several different groups of people. Those who never received an AOT order, those who will have an AOT order in the future, they haven't had it yet at that particular point on the graph, those currently under AOT, and those who are kind of AOT graduates. And what you can see here is, first of all, looking at people who never received AOT, is there was no increase for about 3 years. Notwithstanding, there was a big influx in service capacity with more ACT team slots, more intensive case management. It didn't go to the people who weren't getting AOT. It went to the people who were getting AOT. That's where the new services went, new intensive services. So if you stopped looking right there, and you could do this statistically, it shows that, and we published this, that your chance, if you're a person with serious mental illness who's never going to get AOT, your chance of getting on an ACT team, significantly declined as a function of how many people were coming into the system on AOT orders. Your chance of being discontinued from an ACT team increased as a function of how many people were coming in on AOT orders. But things changed after 3 years. The whole system sort of equilibrated. People graduated from AOT, they moved on. They did better, and meanwhile you had a system with more intensive services, and those services were available to people on AOT or not. And so that in the latter part of the time series that we looked at, there was a steady increase. This effect that I just described went away. So you need to look at this in terms of the long term. So where does that leave us in the end? Well, 10 states that have preventive outpatient commitment statutes, 5 states that do not have outpatient commitment at all. The rest of it, the states have a sort of permissive statutes, but don't use them very much. So what do we say? Should OPC be enacted in other states? Should we recommend that it be implemented more broadly where it's already permitted? We still have this dilemma of autonomy and rights versus benign paternalism. We have cost considerations. We have arguments about the evidence. Let's think about this, and I'll kind of close with this, from the point of view of some ethical principles. You know, you could argue about this from the point of view of distributive justice. I mean, maybe that's the argument about the queue jumping. You could argue about it, you know, from the point of view of humanitarian principles and respect for persons. I think, to clarify it, outpatient commitment should fundamentally be thought about as a practice that overrides people's choices to forego mental health treatment. It's really about that, and so it shouldn't be applied, in my view, to people who just need help accessing that treatment. If the issue really is barriers to care, we should deal with the barriers to care and not rely on an outpatient commitment order to force people to accept the crummy services to which they don't have access anyway. And here's the picture that kind of captures it in the vein of a picture being worth a thousand words. You know, here's somebody in a wheelchair who can't get up the steps. It would be absurd to say, well, here's a treatment order. Get up the steps. No, we wouldn't do that. We'd provide a ramp. And similarly, analogously, we need to provide the ramp, overcoming the barriers that people with serious mental illness have in availing themselves of the treatment. You know, as we learned by thinking about the young men whose victims became the namesakes for these laws, it isn't that people don't want treatment. They might want treatment on their own terms or different terms than the system is able to provide. There are some legitimate reasons why physicians might override some patients' choices in good faith. One has to do with safety and welfare, another has to do with patients lacking capacity to communicate authentic decisions. Ethicist Dan Brock has captured this, I think, in his description of three scenarios for overriding patient choice. He wrote about this in a different context. He was talking about overriding advanced directives, but I think it's apropos here, too. And the first one is where there's good reason to doubt that the patient's manifest decision accurately reflects what that patient would want in a non-impaired state. So this is about whether the person who's telling you that they don't want treatment, whether that's actually an authentic choice or is that impaired by the illness. The second is when the moral authority of the patient's treatment refusal is questionable due to conflict with other important interests of the patient. And the third is when the interests of persons other than the patient warrant overriding patient's choices. I think those are three interesting and probably productive ways to think about when outpatient commitment is appropriate. And I like what the ethicist Carl Elliott has written about this. He said, people do not always mean what they say. They do not always say what they want. They do not always want what they say they want. That much, if not exactly clear, is at least uncontroversial. What is controversial is recognizing this, how to proceed. How are we to interpret statements made by a patient who is now, by virtue of his medical condition, unable to interpret them for us? I think that's interesting, but it also invites the question, do we have an ethical warrant to override patients' bad choices merely on the assumption that such choices must be inauthentic expressions of patients' true preferences? You know, who decides? My conclusion, outpatient commitment is neither a cure-all nor a catastrophe. It's not going to end violence. It's not going to end civil rights. It doesn't affect the majority of people with mental illness in this community. It can't fix a fiscal crisis of the state in which resources for mental health services continue to shrink. But it might be a reasonable and a measured policy that can make effective treatment much more available, consistently available, to those few among us who are in most need of treatment in the community, who at times may actually want it and may not get it any other way.